Welcome back. In this video, I will show you how you can use coordinates to find an algebraic description, a formula, for an important geometric quantity, distance. Let me start with an example. Suppose you and a friend are in a forest. Now, you don't want to get too far apart. But how do you know the distance to your friend if you cannot see each other? How do you even know where your friend is? Well, the latter problem we can solve, right? Use coordinates. So, let's make it more concrete. Suppose you and your friend agreed on a coordinate system measuring in meters. For convenience, let's label the axis 1x and 1y. Now suppose that in this coordinate system you are at 55,20 and your friend is at 15,50. You cannot read off the distance directly from these coordinates, but think of the following. You can reach your friend by first moving parallel to the x-axis and then moving parallel to the y-axis. In the first part, the y-coordinate remains constant. The distance that you have to travel in the first part follows from the change in x-coordinate. This changes from 55 to 15, so the distance is 40 meters. In the same way, you can find the distance for the second part. The x-coordinate remains the same, and the y-coordinate changes from 20 to 50, so the distance is 30 meters. Now you can use an important property of Cartesian coordinate systems. The axes are orthogonal. This means that the two parts of the path are orthogonal as well. They form the legs of a right triangle, and the hypotenuse is the line from you to your friend. We can find the length by the Pythagorean theorem, d squared equals 30 squared plus 40 squared. So the distance d equals the square root of 30 squared plus 40 squared, which is 50 meters. This same setup can be used to find a general formula for the distance between points given their coordinates. Suppose two points, p1 and p2, are given in a coordinate system with coordinates x1, y1 and x2, y2. To find the distance d, we move from p1 to p2 first parallel to the x-axis and then parallel to the y-axis, just as in the earlier example. The length of the first part is given by the absolute value of the change in x-coordinate. Note that we need the absolute value since distances cannot be negative. In the same way, we find the length of the second part. Once again, you see that the two parts of the path form a right triangle and d is precisely the length of the hypotenuse. So, we use the Pythagorean theorem to find d. Note that we can omit the absolute value signs because of the squares. And in the end, we find the following formula. The distance from p1 to p2 equals the square root of x2 minus x1 squared plus y2 minus y1 squared. But wait, we made a choice of Cartesian coordinate system, right? What if we make a different choice? Well, let's do that. And let's label the axes u and v to distinguish them from the previous axes. We can do exactly the same trick of constructing a right triangle, find the length of the legs, and then use the Pythagorean theorem to find d. You see that, although the coordinates are different, the formula is the same. And of course, it gives the same answer. Distance is a geometric quantity, so it should not depend on the coordinate system that we use. It may seem a bit of a miracle that the distance formula is the same in all Cartesian coordinate systems. Nevertheless, it is true. And you will see some examples in the exercises. You see that the invention of coordinates enable you to find formulas for geometric quantities like distance. More generally speaking, the idea connects two important mathematical fields. Geometry, which is all about shapes, curves, intersections and distance, and so on, and algebra, which is about manipulation of formulas and solving equations. This was very revolutionary in the 17th century, and it was of fundamental importance for the development of calculus. In the sections to come, you will see many more examples of this connection. See you there.